13 of Matthew, and let's read it, and then we'll look at it. So it's parables, and thankfully, Jesus kind of explains his parables as well, so I don't have to add too much. Jesus went out of the house and sat by the lake. Such a large crowd gathered round him that he got into a boat and sat in it, while all the people stood on the shore. Then he told them many things in parables, saying, a farmer went out to sow his seed. As he was scattering the seed, some fell along the path, and the birds came and ate it up. Some fell on rocky places where it did not have much soil. It sprang up quickly because the soil was shallow, but when the sun came up, the plants were scorched, and they withered because they had no root. Other seed fell among thorns, which grew up and choked the plants. Still others fell on good soil, where it produced a crop, 160 or 30 times what was sown. Whoever has ears, let them hear. The disciples came to him and asked, why do you speak to the people in parables? He replied, because the knowledge of the secrets of the kingdom of heaven has been given to you, but not to them. Whoever has will be given more, and they will have an abundance. Whoever does not have, even what they have will be taken from them. This is why I speak to them in parables. Though seeing, they do not see. Though hearing, they do not hear or understand. In them is fulfilled the prophecy of Isaiah. You'll be ever hearing, but never understanding. You'll be ever seeing, but never perceiving. For this people's heart has become calloused. They hardly hear with their ears, and they have closed their eyes. Otherwise, they might see with their eyes, hear with their ears, understand with their hearts, and turn, and I would heal them. But blessed are your eyes because they see, and your ears because they hear. For truly I tell you, many prophets and righteous people longed to see what you see, but did not see it, and to hear what you hear, but did not hear it. Listen then to what the parable of the sower means. When anyone hears the message about the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what was sown in their heart. This is the seed sown along the path. The seed falling on rocky ground refers to someone who hears the word and at once receives it with joy. But since they have no root, they last only a short time. When trouble or persecution comes because of the word, they quickly fall away. The seed falling among the thorns refers to someone who hears the word, but the worries of this life and the deceitfulness of wealth choke the word and making it unfruitful. But the seed falling on good soil refers to someone who hears the word and understands it. This is the one who produces a crop yielding 160 or 30 times what was sown. Jesus told them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like a man who sowed good seed in his field. But while everyone was sleeping, his enemy came and sowed weeds among the wheat and went away. When the wheat sprouted and formed ears, then the weeds also appeared. The owner's servants came to him and said, sir, didn't you sow good seed in your field? Where then did the weeds come from? An enemy did this, he replied. The servants asked him, do you want us to go and pull them up? No, he answered, because while you are pulling up the weeds, you may uproot the wheat with them. Let both grow together until the harvest. At that time, I will tell the harvesters, first collect the weeds and tie them in bundles to be burned. Then gather the wheat and bring it into my barn. He told them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed, which a man took and planted in his field. Though it is the smallest of all seeds, yet when it grows, it is the largest of garden plants and becomes a tree, so that the birds come and perch in its branches. He told them still another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like yeast that a woman took and mixed in into about 30 kilograms of flour until it worked all through the dough. Jesus spoke all these things to the crowd in parables. He did not say anything to them without using a parable. So was fulfilled what was spoken through the prophet. I will open my mouth in parables. I will utter things hidden since the creation of the world. Then he left the crowd and went into the house. His disciples came to him and said, "Explain to us the parable of the weeds in the field." He answered, "The one who sowed the good seed is the Son of Man. The field is the world, and the good seed stands for the people of the kingdom. The weeds are the people of the evil one, and the enemy who sows them is the devil. The harvest is the end of the age, and the harvesters are angels. As the weeds are pulled up and burned in the fire, so it will be at the end of the age. The Son of Man," "the Son of Man will send out his angels, and they will weed out of his kingdom everything that causes sin and all who do evil. They will throw them into the blazing furnace, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Then the righteous will shine like the sun in the kingdom of their Father. Whoever has ears, let them hear. The kingdom of heaven is like a treasure hidden in a field. When a man found it, he hid it again, and then, in his joy, went and sold all he had and bought that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant looking for fine pearls. When he found one of great value, he went away and sold everything he had and bought it. Once again, the kingdom of heaven is like a net that was let down into the lake and caught all kinds of fish. When it was full, the fishermen pulled it up on the shore. Then they sat down and collected the good fish in baskets, but threw the bad away. This is how it will be at the end of the age. The angels will come and separate the wicked from the righteous and throw them into the blazing furnace, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Have you understood all these things?" Jesus asked. "Yes," they replied. He said to them, "Therefore, every teacher of the law who has become a disciple in the kingdom of heaven is like the owner of a house who brings out of his storeroom new treasures as well as old." When Jesus had finished these parables, he moved on from there, coming to his hometown. He began teaching the people in their synagogue, and they were amazed. "Where did this man get this wisdom and these miraculous powers?" they asked. "Isn't this the carpenter's son? Isn't his mother's name Mary? And aren't his brothers James, Joseph, Simon, Judas? Aren't all his sisters with us? Where then did this man get all these things?" And they took offense at him. But Jesus said to them, "A prophet is not without honor, except in his own town and in his own home." And he did not do many miracles there because of their lack of faith. So, there we go, I got through that eventually. So there's these four soils. The farmer, who's God, scatters seeds, and they end up in these different places. And Jesus speaks in parables because he wants those who are actually paying attention, who are hungry and thirsty. You know, Jesus said, "Those who are hungry and thirsty, follow me, and I will give you living water so you won't be thirsty again." Jesus calls those who are hungry, those who are passionate, those who are, just really excited and willing to sacrifice everything for God's kingdom. If you see the big parables that take up the chunk of 13, are all about soil. But then there's those very short little parables, aren't there, of the hidden treasure and the pearls. And his point is that actually the treasure is hidden. Jesus talked about not throwing pearls to pigs, not giving what is sacred to dogs. And so Jesus talks in parables, teaches in parables, so that only those who are listening will actually receive what he's trying to give them. Because the message of God's kingdom is a very precious one. Because ultimately at the heart of it is the fact that Jesus died and gave himself for us. And you know, we sing the song, we'll never know how much it cost, cost to see your son upon the cross. And so Jesus isn't going to just share this message with those who don't care. Does that make sense? If you've got something very valuable and precious, whether that's a material thing or a person in your life, you don't entrust those things or those people to people that aren't going to care for them. You know, those of you that are parents, and especially if your children are going on to secondary school, the choice of where to send them to school, or even if they're starting school, is important, because you want to know that the people that you are entrusting your precious babies, as Grace would say, are actually going to care for them and kind of invest in them, and take care of them, and look after them, and not just treat them with without any care at all. Does that make sense? So equally, you know, your mobile phones these days that cost, you know, several hundreds of pounds, you usually put in a case, don't you? Because it's like, well, if something happens to it, I don't want it to be smashed. And, you know, your car, you'll keep it very nice and tidy, and you won't scrape it along roads with bushes in case there's something in there that's going to scratch your car, or you won't go through potholes because you're worried about the suspension. You protect and you care and you look after and you invest time and money into protecting the things that are valuable to you. And so the gospel of Jesus Christ is so, so valuable that even though God wants to get it out to as many people as possible, he still treats it in the way that you would if something really, really precious. So let's just look at some of the things that he says. So the first seeds go along the path. And it says, well, let's go to the bit where Jesus explains it, because there's no point me explaining something that Jesus has explained, because I'll do a terrible job compared to Jesus, which isn't surprising. But let's go to verse 24. Not 24. Where am I? 18. It says, when anyone hears the message about the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what was sown in their heart. This is the seed sown along the path. And so our job and our, you know, our great commission that Noel Richards was singing was actually our job is to preach the message of the kingdom, the gospel of Jesus, the fact that all have sinned, we're all sinners, we've all turned away from God, and as a result we need to repent, and we need to put our faith in Jesus, who offers us salvation and the forgiveness of sins, so that we can have eternal life and be reunited with Father God. And so that's the message, but actually a lot of the time it can be quite hard for people to understand. You know, for example, the Muslims really find it hard to understand that God would allow himself to be killed. That really is hard for them to understand. Other people maybe, on the other hand, might consider, well, the bit about us needing to repent and we're basically bad people, they look at their own lives and they compare them to, you know, serial murderers or rapists or, you know, abusers, and they say, you know what, I'm a good person. I don't understand why I'd need to repent. And there are all these ways that people just don't understand the gospel of Jesus. You know, there are others, you know, maybe have a sort of religious mindset, think, what? I struggle to understand the fact that there's nothing that you can do to earn salvation, that everything is a gift of God's grace, that actually, you know, you don't have to follow a set of rules to earn God's salvation. It's given to you freely. So there are all these kind of barriers that people can stumble upon and misunderstand the message of God's kingdom. Or, you know, the way that Jesus teaches everything, that it's upside down. That actually, if you want to become the greatest, make yourself the least. The first shall be last. That people, you know, at the time would consider the worst of sinners were entering the kingdom first. And so there's all this kind of potential for the gospel of Jesus to be misunderstood. And so if we don't preach the gospel clearly and also teach others, if you remember the Great Commission that Jesus gave us, which was to teach people, to proclaim the gospel, to proclaim the good news of the kingdom, and to teach, which means it requires some understanding because it's not always as simple. In one sense, it's very simple, but in other ways, it can be easily misunderstood. And the devil knows this, and so he will come in and try and prevent the gospel from being preached. He will prevent it from being understood. So first of all, he'll keep us silent when we need to speak out. Secondly, he'll confuse things, confuse the message, maybe send out a message that's different, and we'll see that in the next soils. And he snatches it away before the Holy Spirit is able to take that message and use it to transform that person's life. And so we need to, whenever we preach the gospel, it's so important that actually we precede it and cover it in prayer, because the enemy doesn't want the gospel to be preached. He's completely against it. He either prevents it from happening or he distorts the message. So it's really important that we're wise to this. And so that's the seed along the path. Then it says, the seed falling on rocky ground refers to someone who hears the word and at once receives it with joy. But since they have no root, they last only a short time. And, you know, sometimes people come to God and they're very excited about what Jesus has to offer. Eternal life, wonderful, peace, wonderful, all of that. But then it comes to picking up your cross daily and following Jesus. Can we just possibly get the song that we sang this morning, It's Sovereign Over Us? If we could just get that, because as I was kind of singing this song, it kind of revealed to me what these sort of parables are talking about. So if we can just get the verse, there we go. So it says, there is strength within the sorrow, there is beauty in our tears, and you meet us in our mourning with a love that casts out fear. And if you go to the next one, you are working in our waiting, sanctifying us when beyond our understanding, you're teaching us to trust. So sometimes, you know, especially if you're a new Christian, and even if you've been a Christian for many years, there are some things that we just don't understand that God does. And he's always teaching us to trust. If we carry on. There we go. So it says, your plans are still to prosper. And it's like, actually, we all love that, don't we? We all love that. And, you know, prosperity is good. And it's true. What it says there, your plans are still to prosper. But let's read the next verse. Next line. Says, you've not forgotten us, you're with us in the fire and the flood. Now, obviously we've seen on the news what's been happening in Spain, and there's been floods and things like that. Many people have lost their lives, and it's been really tragic. And so it's like, well, we're singing this verse, and it says, your plans are still to prosper, however, we're currently in fire and flood. You know? And sometimes, and we'll look at the next bit of the parable, we want the prosper bit. And it says, are still to prosper. What that means is, just remember that whilst you're in the fire and flood, God still wants the best for you. But like a good parent, he doesn't just keep you shielded from all the tough things in life. Because it's in those tough moments that we grow and we actually cling closer to God. You know, when the fire comes, when things get really tough or scary, or we're worried, when the flood comes and we can't cope, we cry out to God, don't we? And ultimately, his ultimate plan is to prosper us. Ultimately, eternal life. But sometimes we misunderstand what prosperity means and think, well, God just wants me to be rich. He wants me to have wonderful relationships and meet the perfect person. He wants me to have a nice car and a nice house, and he wants my kids' education to be amazing, and he wants me to live in peace, and I'll just come to church skipping and clapping and just being wonderful. But actually, sometimes it's like a fire and flood, isn't it? It's like a fire and flood, and we're just surviving. But ultimately, his plan to prosper us is still true. And so let's just look at, going back to the passage, it says in verse 20, the seed falling on rocky ground refers to someone who hears the word and at once receives it with joy. But since they have no root, they last only a short time. When trouble, things like fires or floods come, persecution comes because of the word, they quickly fall away. And the root here, what do roots do? They draw up water, don't they, from the ground. And as we read all these parables, water, the Holy Spirit's often described as water. You know, we were singing, pour out your spirit, weren't we? Pour out your spirit. The Holy Spirit is something that God can pour out on us. And so water here is the Holy Spirit. And so if you've got the Bible there and you're reading it and it fills you with joy, but if you haven't actually encountered the Spirit of Jesus, his Holy Spirit, and you haven't got the presence of God dwelling in you, when you're in trouble or when you're scared because persecution comes, because you're all alone without Jesus' Spirit in you, then God's word isn't there to comfort you. It is, but ultimately you haven't actually got the presence, the person who this word is all about and who wrote this word. You haven't got the presence. You've got, in theory, you know, if a child is in trouble, they might have all the messages or letters that their parents have written them, but there's nothing like actually having the presence of a father or a mother with you when you're in trouble as a child. Does that make sense? So we receive the word because this tells us what God is like and what he says about us and what he thinks, but unless we actually have a relationship with the person that this word is about, when trouble comes, we'll fall away. Does that make sense? So it's really important that churches preach the word, preach it clearly, preach it a lot, pray, and make sure that it's understood as much as it possibly can, because we know the devil wants to snatch that away. But then equally, we also, as well as preaching the word, need to actually introduce people to the presence of the Holy Spirit. How do you fill your life with the presence of the Holy Spirit? So we look at things that stop us from receiving the Holy Spirit. You've got to remember, God gives grace to the humble, doesn't he? And ultimately, Jesus' presence being with us is an act of his grace. And so things that can stop the Holy Spirit from coming in, pride, big blocker to the Holy Spirit, not trusting and obeying the Bible. You know, it talks about actually trusting God, trusting that his word will come through. So, you know, at the very start, you might be very excited, and you read all these wonderful things about what God's going to do, and then you see how it actually plays out in reality, and you go, this isn't quite what I was expecting. And at that moment, it's where you require to trust God and trust his promises. And trust that in some way, you know, when you know someone and you know they've delivered for you in the past, does that mean, you know, they've promised something and they've delivered. If you don't know someone, you don't have that assurance that they're going to come through for you. Does that make sense? But if you actually know God and you know his presence with you, then you know what God does. Yes, he might make things look, you know, seem scary and might cause you to kind of really kind of cling on to his promises and go deeper with him, just like the roots here. But because you know him, you know his promises never fail. And actually, you don't have to fall away. You can hold on and you can walk with him through trouble, through persecution. Does that make sense? If all you've got is the actual words but don't know the author, then you're going to fall away. What does it say? Right, so then it says, when trouble or persecution comes with the word, they quickly fall away. Then we've got the other one. The seed falling among the thorns refers to someone who hears the word. The word of this life and the deceitful wealth choke the word, making it unfruitful. Again, what's lacking here is air. Being choked. Being choked, you can't breathe. And as well as being like water, God's spirit is often described as wind or air, or breath. And so this is the kind of opposite end of the scale. So this is someone who maybe isn't struggling with persecution or trouble. Actually, they've come to Jesus, they've received his word, and they're living quite a good life, They've got a nice car, they've got plenty of money, but ultimately they've got loads of distractions. They've got things going on in their life that are all going well, and it's drawing them away from God's word. And basically saying, you don't actually need that. You can survive, or you can actually have a good life without obeying God's word. Because look how much wealth you have. Put your trust in wealth. And so, neither are right or wrong. So if you're suffering persecution and trouble and feels like you're going through fires and floods, or if you're wealthy and you have lots of things going on, you're very busy, neither of those are, it's not that you have to have one or the other. Some people teach that Christians need to be very poor and have lots of trouble going on and all of that stuff. And some people teach that Christians need to be very wealthy and healthy and everything's wonderful. But the truth is, it's not about either of those. You can be in both of those situations and love Jesus. It's actually, are you being, getting water of the Holy Spirit? Are you rooted in the Holy Spirit, and are you breathing the Holy Spirit in your life? In the end, do you know the presence of Jesus? Because other things will come in and try to stop you. And Jesus is very clear about the deceitfulness of wealth. Wealth, as we all know, promises so much, doesn't it? It promises us that actually, once we're wealthy, we won't have any trouble. But it's interesting, this person has the worries of this life. Often people who have tons of money get very worried, because when things go a bit crazy in the world, they often lose a lot of their money, don't they? I think my mum always used to joke that, it doesn't matter what happens in the world because I've got no money anyway. And in one sense, that's great, isn't it? Not worrying about it. But that doesn't mean that we have to be poor and not have money, because ultimately we're blessed to be a blessing. But if we're deceived by our wealth, in other words, we think that our wealth can give us the life that Jesus offers us, then we're badly mistaken, aren't we? And Jesus had an encounter with a very rich young man who had pretty much everything. His life was set up, and Jesus recognized that actually he'd been deceived by his wealth. He'd been deceived by his wealth, and so Jesus gave him a challenge, which I think he eventually passed, but not at first. So wealth and worries of life. So, you can be distracted, can't you, by things. And Jesus was very clear about, actually, he taught in parables because he wanted the people that were paying attention to hear. And so there are lots of things, the world is mad about attention, getting people's attention. If you, obviously, if you have a smartphone or you have social media, all of these companies now have lots of, psychiatrists, psychologists, people that understand how the brain works in terms of gaining people's attention and keeping it. And obviously, you know, there's all these algorithms that make social media, smartphones, apps, games, whatever, really, really addictive. Because there is a battle going on for our attention. And ultimately, the enemy wants to, will give us anything to put our mind to or focus on other than God's kingdom and his word and his presence. And so we can be distracted, whether that's being tired. So you can make us really busy on a Saturday night, you know, getting us staying up very late so that when we come in the morning, we're half asleep. Anyone asleep? Not yet. Or he can make us so stressed out about, and so we're rather than listening to God's word or worshipping, we're worried, what we're going to do Monday morning, you know, and he can hit us that way as well. And so he wants to distract us, but ultimately, Jesus wants our attention. You know, what does he say? He says, what does he say? Let me just find it. Verse 9, whoever has ears, let them hear. Whoever has ears, let them hear. In other words, whoever's actually listening, then they can understand what I'm saying. Then there's this verse, I just want to go back a little bit. It says why Jesus kind of explains why he speaks in parables. And in verse 12, he says this strange sentence. Whoever has will be given more, and they will have an abundance. Whoever does not have, even what they have, will be taken from them. And so on first reading, you're like, Jesus, that doesn't make sense. How can you take away stuff from people that don't have any stuff? And I think what he's saying here is the ability to actually listen and understand what he's saying so that you can actually receive what God is offering, even that ability to do that will be taken away. So you might not have received God's kingdom, but the fact that you have the ability and the potential to receive God's kingdom, that will be taken away because you're not actually interested in even trying to find out. If that makes sense. So they're kind of different things, but the ability to actually understand God's kingdom will be taken away as well. Whereas actually, if you are paying attention, then you will be given further wisdom and revelation to actually understand even more about what God's saying and all the hidden things. And we know that ultimately, we need Jesus to reveal the scripture to us properly. You know, if his disciples needed it, then we definitely need Jesus to help us. You know, Jesus opened the scriptures to his own disciples in a way that they weren't able to understand on their own. And so if we think that we can get everything from the Bible that we need without Jesus helping us do that, we're mistaken. So there's that. And then let's have a look. Next soil. The final soil, the fourth soil, it says, verse 23, but the seed falling on good soil refers to someone who hears the word and understands it through the help of the Holy Spirit, revealing stuff to them. This is the one who produces a crop yielding 100, 60, or 30 times what was sown. And ultimately that means that, you know, the seed goes into the ground, produces a plant which then produces far more seeds, and that multiplication of God's kingdom happens because they produce fruit. And you know, Jesus talks about remaining in him, doesn't he? You know, without me, remain in me and I will remain in you, and you know, you'll produce fruit, and any branches that don't produce fruit, they'll be cut off and thrown into the fire. So it's really important that we stay rooted in Jesus so that we can be fruitful. And that is ultimately how God's kingdom grows, through individuals laying down their lives, being rooted, being watered by the Holy Spirit, breathing the Holy Spirit, having that relationship with Jesus, and producing fruit, a fruitful life of love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, gentleness, self-control, that then impacts others, and they hear the word because you're sharing it with them, and they then become a seed like you as well. And it goes on and on and on. And we'll see how quickly the kingdom of God can grow in one of these other parables that Jesus talks about. The next one is the weeds. So in verse 24, it says Jesus told them another parable. So it's about a farmer who has a field, sows good seed, but then when everyone's asleep, the enemy, the devil comes in, sows bad seeds, evil seeds, and then they grow up, and basically it's hard to tell which are the weeds and which are the wheat. And you know, any of you have a garden, I know sometimes, you know, if you have grandchildren or children and they don't know what they're doing, you don't really want them weeding your garden because they may pull up something that's actually very precious and valuable. And this is what Jesus is saying here, because the servants, in verse 28, say, "Do you want us to go and pull them up?" Which seems like a reasonable thing to do, doesn't it? You know, you want to get rid of the weeds. But Jesus, well, God's ways are much higher than our ways. And if we were in charge, we would just root. You talk to people who don't know Jesus, and they, you know, they say, "Oh, why do you not believe in God?" And their answer is always, "Well, there's lots of evil and suffering in the world." And their solution is, get rid of all the bad people. You know, and you kind of think, "Oh, yeah, that makes sense. If we get rid of all the bad people, then the world will be good." But if you do that, then the bad people, which everyone, doesn't have a chance to actually turn, repent, and receive God's forgiveness and salvation, and ultimately become the wheat that is mentioned in this story. And so God, being a patient, merciful, gracious, compassionate God, allows all these things to grow together in his field. So we've got people out in the world, we've got people who know Jesus, love Jesus, all growing together. And God waits until, it says, the end of age. And then the separation happens, where God is able to judge everyone rightly through his perfect justice. And he separates out the weeds and separates out the wheat. You know, whenever there's some sort of, I've noticed, from whenever there's like a Christian revival, often there's some bad stuff that happens with it. And people try and say, well, because there was some bad stuff, then the good stuff's not valid. But the truth is, you know, when God moves, yes, there will be good stuff, and the devil will try and do his bad stuff with the weeds. And if we spend so long trying to root out all the bad, we can end up actually stopping people that could be wheat from becoming wheat. Does that make sense? So we're very quick to judge and want to kind of get rid of people. But actually, God's so much more patient than us. And he knows everything. And if he chooses to allow the bad seeds or the bad crops to grow, or the weeds to grow with the wheat, then we shouldn't be going around trying to identify who are the weeds and trying to kick them out, if that makes sense. So, verse 29, he says, No, he answered, "because while you're pulling up the weeds, you may uproot the wheat with them. Let both grow together until the harvest." And it's the harvest time that God separates us and decides who is wheat and who is weeds. And that's because we're precious. We're precious to God. And so he is, you know, the Bible talks about he doesn't want anyone to perish. You know, John 3:16, God so loved the world that he gave his only son. Doesn't want anyone to perish, but he wants them to have eternal life. He's desperate for everyone to do that. And so he's willing to wait, and he's willing to allow these weeds to grow at the same time. And then he talks about the mustard seed. And, you know, there are various types of mustard plants. You know, mustard can be a very little thing, but also mustard can be a tree that grows to about 8 feet tall in some cases. But the seeds are tiny. The seeds are tiny. And God's trying to explain what his kingdom is like. It starts off very tiny and insignificant, but then it says it grows into the largest of garden plants and becomes a tree. so that the birds come and perch in its branches. In other words, it gives a place of rest to people. God's kingdom starts off small. That could be you speaking to your neighbor, to your friend, to your colleague. Just one person. But the multiplication can happen like that. And as we saw, you know, at the end of the soils parable, it talks about produces a crop yielding 160 or 30 times what was sown. And if you multiply that out, it can grow very quickly and very big. So yes, so it becomes a tree, so the birds come and perch in its branches. And so we shouldn't despise small things, you know, small beginnings, because God is able to take the smallest things, and that's one of the promises for our church, that God will take the smallest family, clan, and multiply it into a great nation. And so that's what God's kingdom's about, multiplication. And the way it happens, he tells another parable about yeast. He says, the kingdom of heaven is like a yeast that a woman took and mixed into about 30 kilograms of flour. Now, flour is obviously made from wheat. And so he's talking about, I guess, the people. And mixing yeast into it. Yeast. Now, yeast is very tiny. You can't really see it, I don't think. Or you can kind of see powder, but the actual, it's kind of, you need a microscope to probably see it properly. But what it does, it feeds off the sugar, doesn't it, in the dough or the flour, and produces air, which makes this bread rise. I'm not a baker, by the way, so don't ask me anything more than that, but I know that yeast produces carbon dioxide, and that makes the bread rise. And so, and it does it kind of all in a sort of hidden way, you know? You can't see it. So it's not like we can see the Holy Spirit, but it does work its way. It should be mixed in. So, you know, a church of 30 kilograms of flour, that's, you know, a large number of people. And when you've got a large number of people that are wheat, that are truly serving God, and the Holy Spirit is kind of ingrained and kind of meshed in, then it produces this bread, doesn't it, that actually is brings life. And that's what God's kingdom needs to be like, where we're just we're going about our business, and we, on the surface of it, we might not look any different, but ultimately, when we've got the Holy Spirit working in our lives, he makes things move, you know. Yeah, just absolutely critical. I mean, if you've ever baked some bread and you were expecting it to rise and it doesn't, it's quite a disappointment, really, isn't it? You're just like, oh, put this in the bin. Yeah, so that's what God's kingdom's like. And then he goes on to explain, obviously, the parable of the weeds, which we kind of covered already. And so I just want to skip, because I don't want to spend ages. It says, verse 44, if we go to the hidden treasure. It says, the kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field. When a man found it, he hid it again, and then in his joy went and sold all he had and bought that field. So, the key thing here is he's had an encounter with the true kingdom of God. And when you encounter God's kingdom, truly encounter God's kingdom, you see how precious and valuable it is. It's described here as treasure. And it might not be easy to find, but if you seek, you will find, because that's what Jesus says. And this man has found God's kingdom. He's discovered its immense value. And this has brought about great joy. And he sold all he had and bought that field. In other words, you know, Paul has that verse, doesn't he? And, you know, we've got that worship song. All I once held dear, I've counted loss. spent and worthless now compared to this, knowing Jesus, knowing the King of God's kingdom, knowing Jesus. And that's what's happened here. He's discovered knowing Jesus, and as a result, everything else in his life is worthless. So sell it so that he can just have that relationship with King Jesus. What religions try to do is say, to follow Jesus, you need to go and sell everything. And you can't have anything nice. And and then you will find Jesus. It doesn't work like that. That's just religion. Ultimately, the key word in this verse here is joy. If we, you know, God loves a cheerful giver. And you don't become a cheerful giver if you're just told to do something. You know, the people telling you, they might be right, that, you know, you do need to sell some things. But actually, if you're doing it based on some rules and what someone's telling you to do, then it's pointless. What you need to do is discover the precious, valuable nature of a relationship with Jesus, and then everything else that you have in life is just not as important, not as valuable. And so you're willing to give up or sell or get rid of everything else in your life. Don't try and just get rid of everything else and then hope that you find Jesus. Encounter Jesus first. And then in your joy, you'll get, well, I'm not saying you have to get rid of everything, but you'll get rid of anything that Jesus wants you to get rid of. You know, I could preach from the front saying, you need to do this, you need to get rid of this, get rid of that, give this money to these people, just get rid of any sort of idol in your life. But if it's just me banging on about it and you haven't encountered Jesus for yourself, then it'll just destroy you, because you'll give up all these things and then you'll be like, well, now what? But actually, when you encounter Jesus, everything else becomes worthless. Everything else compared to knowing Jesus. I'm not saying they're worthless completely. Obviously, there's still worth, but compared to knowing Jesus, they're worthless. And so you can give up things in joy. You know, just as the, the widow who put an offering into the basket, she did it because she knew who she was giving it to. The people putting large sums of money were putting it in because they thought they were doing God a favor, or they were doing it because they wanted to appear religious and righteous. But actually, discovering the true treasure of God's kingdom, which is Jesus himself, will give you great joy, and nothing will get in the way of following after Jesus. Similarly, next verse 45, a one verse parable. These are really nice, aren't they? The one verse parables. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant looking for fine pearls. Oh, actually, it's two verses, isn't it? The last one was one verse, wasn't it? When he found one of great value, he went away and sold everything he had and bought it. Again, it's that same thing of actually nothing else compares to knowing Jesus. I'll give up everything to find this great value. And you can tell how much someone values God's kingdom in that, you know, their priorities in life. What's the priorities? What are your priorities? That will show you how much you value it. You know, Jesus talks about where your treasure is, there your heart will lie. You know, your treasure, we all have treasure. We all have a certain amount of money. We all have a certain amount of time. We all have a certain amount of skills and resources. Where do those things go? Where will we find those things? Where is all our time spent? Where is all our money spent? What do we do with the skills and talents that we have? Where those things are is where your heart is. And God wants our hearts to be in his kingdom. And then the final parable is the one about fish. It says, once again, the kingdom of heaven is like a net that was let down into the lake and caught all kinds of fish. When it was full, the fishermen pulled it up on the shore. Then they sat down and collected the good fish in baskets, but threw the bad away. This is how it will be at the end of the age. The angels will come and separate the wicked from the righteous and throw them into the blazing furnace where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. You know, Jesus doesn't hold back. He speaks the truth. People, you know, there are churches that shy away from preaching this, who've maybe redefined their doctrines to say, oh no, God loves everybody. And actually, you know, even at the light party, I was sharing about how God from the very beginning is in the business of separating light from darkness, sheep from goats, wheat from weeds, or wheat from chaff. In this case, good fish and bad fish. And then Jesus says, have you understood all these things? Jesus asks. Yes, they replied. He said to them, therefore, every teacher of the law who has become a disciple in the kingdom of heaven is like the owner of a house who brings out of his storeroom new treasures as well as old. In other words, when you understand God's kingdom, you understand the Old Testament and you understand the New Testament. And you understand how actually the Old Testament is pointing to Jesus. And Jesus was bringing out these new treasures that the, you know, the Pharisees, they were all wanting judgment to come. They were all wanting their enemies to be destroyed and a new king to rule and reign, just like, you know, like David, and they'd be able to have their temple back and all of that. But what Jesus did was he showed them how, if you look at Matthew, I think Victor made a comment about Matthew, and that almost every chapter, Jesus harks back to the Old Testament, doesn't he? We haven't covered it this morning, but we read it, and Jesus talks about Isaiah, doesn't he? And how, actually, the Old Testament just is all about Jesus. It all points to Jesus. And then Jesus brings his teachings, which are the new treasures. But the Pharisees didn't want the new treasures. They just wanted someone to come in, destroy all their enemies. But the reality is Jesus didn't come to do that. He came to teach first. He came to bring the kingdom of God, to help them understand the scriptures properly. And then judgment comes at the end of the day, at the end of the age, the harvest. So it's important that we don't throw out, you know, that we teach the whole Bible. If you're a disciple of Jesus, we teach the whole Bible. We don't just pick out the nice verses. We don't just pick out the New Testament and all of that. We realize that it all points to Jesus. And then there's just this little story at the end, isn't there, about his family. It says, when Jesus had finished these parables, he moved on from there. Coming to his hometown, he began teaching in the synagogue. So he was in Nazareth and teaching, and they were amazed. But what they didn't recognize, they still saw him as just one of them. He just saw him as just another human. And so that's why they were surprised. It says, did this man, notice this, seeing him as a man, Where then did this man get all these things? And they took offense at him. In other words, they hadn't recognized that he was God in human flesh, because they were like, well, we know his mother. We know his brothers, James, Joseph, Simon, Judas. They knew his sisters. Where then did this man get all these things? And they took offense at him. But then Jesus said to them, a prophet is not without honor except in his own town and in his own home. And he did not do many miracles there because of their lack of faith. So we need to have the right view of Jesus. You know, yes, he was fully man, but he was also fully God. He was fully God. And as a result, he could do things, all these miracles. But they just saw him as a man. And so having the right view of Jesus is really, really important. Jesus asks his disciples, who do you say I am? And I guess the question, the biggest question is, who is Jesus to you? Is he just a nice man who taught nice things? Or is he the God that came to this earth, showed us how to live, denied himself to the point of death, death on a cross, for the sake of us, offers us salvation because he defeated death, he defeated sin, and all we need to do is put our faith in him. He didn't do miracles there because they lacked faith. They lacked faith. They just saw him as another one of them. And so this morning, you know, if you don't know Jesus, and maybe you just thought he was a good teacher, a good human, actually he was the Son of God, and he came to offer us salvation. He came to open a way back to the Father by laying down his life so that we could have eternal life. And that is, you know, salvation is the greatest miracle, and it requires faith. It requires that actually, yes, you know what, God, you are right, you are God. I'm going to put my faith in you. I want to be in your kingdom, and I want to receive that joy that comes from discovering your kingdom, and I want to have that root that means that I stay rooted in your kingdom and grow and produce a harvest. And that is a miracle. You know, God can take the most unlikely candidate and build his kingdom. And maybe that's you this morning. If it is, please do speak to either myself or my dad before you go, so that God can do a miracle in your life. He's a God of miracles, and he can take anything and anyone and make it just grow into something beautiful, precious, and life-giving. Amen.